I will. So I intended to present a few examples using where we can study the long-time behavior of PDEs using entropy techniques. But then I decided to focus on one example. Okay, so that's the real title. So I prefer to spend more time on one. And so the example I chose is actually the most recent one, if you refer to the abstract, where what we look at is we look at the high dimensional scaling for Metropolis Hastings algorithms. Okay, so that will be the subject of the talk. This is a joint work with Benjamin Jourdain, who is in CERMIX, and Blaise Mazzucedo, who used to be a postdoc with Benjamin and myself, and is now back to Poland. Okay, so I will present Metropolis Hastings algorithms. I don't think we had so many talks about Metropolis Hastings algorithm for the moment, so I will present a little bit what is this about. And then I will introduce the previous results which have been proven for the large dimensional scaling for this problem. And then something about long-time convergence using entropy techniques. Yes. And then some practical counterparts of these theoretical results. Okay. So let me start with the classical Metropolis Hastings algorithms. What is it about? It's about sampling a measure. So we are given a measure on Rn with some density p, okay, and we want to build a Markov chain which is ergodic with respect to p. Okay, and there is a general, very general procedure to build such a Markov chain, which consists in two steps. The first one is to propose a move. So you are at time k, okay, you are at a position xk, and you propose a move to x hat k plus 1, okay, according to some Markov density kernel q here, which is given, okay. And I explicitly indicate here with the superscript n the dimension in which we are working, Rn, because what will be the scaling in my talk? The scaling will be n goes to infinity. Okay, so this is why there is a little n here. Okay. For the moment, you can forget about it because okay, just you are at xk, you propose from xk to x hat k plus 1. And then the second step is acceptance rejection step. You accept the move, namely you go to x hat k plus 1, or you reject according to a probability. So you compute this ratio, which is called the Metropolis-Hastings ratio. It's this formula, which is explicit in function of p and q, and which is independent, which does not depend for which you can only know p and q up to a multiplicative constant. So this is important for applications in many cases. You compute this alpha, and then you draw a random number according to uniform law on 0, 1. If this random number is smaller than alpha, you accept. Otherwise, you reject. Okay, and so you stay at xk. And you can show on the quite loose assumptions that this, so what you can check is that by construction p is an invariant measure for this dynamics. And on the loose assumptions, you can show that you are actually ergodic with respect to p. Okay, and this chain is actually not only an invariant measure, but it's reversible with respect to p. Okay. So this is a general algorithm. So it's very general, so it means that in practice, there is some problems to apply it in full generality. The problem is the following. Here, q is whatever you like, okay? And of course, the efficiency of the algorithm crucially depends on q, okay? So if you are in high dimension and you have a probability measure p, you should choose a q which brings you to important regions with respect to p, namely to regions where p is large, well, high probability regions, okay? And so typically, there are situations where you don't know where to go, okay? And so if you go too far, so if q brings you too far from the starting point x hat k, most of the time you will reject, okay? That's bad. And if you go too close to your initial point, okay, you will accept, but you will not move, okay? So there is a balance to find between exploration and exploitation, a little bit like in optimization strategies. You have to visit, but you have to accept. And since you are in high dimension, it's difficult to tune the queue. Okay, so this is a general problem for Metropolis Hastings algorithms. Okay, that's and so there are papers for specific problems, like easing problems, where people are just working on choosing a correct queue. Okay, But here we are quite in a quite general setting, and so we'll choose for Q something quite simple, which is just a random walk. Okay, so we will here just move from X to Y according to some Gaussians with some variance. And then we will ask about how to choose the variance as a function of n. This will be the question. Okay. So this is the definition of the random walk, Metropolis Hastings. So here I'm specifying the Q. It just starting from xnk, from xk, I just add a Gaussian random variable with variance sigma square. Okay. And so sigma will be the parameter I was talking about before. Okay, if sigma is very large, you move a lot. If sigma is very small, you just stay around. So this is the density associated to that. And you remark that this is symmetric. So Q of xy is equal to Q of yx. So it means that in this case, the acceptance ratio is a little bit simpler. You just have the probability at the end point divided by the probability at the starting point. Okay. So the idea is that if you increase the probability by moving, you will always accept. Okay. And if you decrease the probability by moving to y, you will accept with some probability, which is just this ratio. Okay. There is another standard choice, which is a little bit more educated in terms of the target, because you use here, instead of using just a Gaussian, you use a drift also, which knows about the target, which is the gradient of log of p, the drift. Okay. So this is nothing but you can see that as a discretization of the underlying overdamped Langevin dynamics, which is ergodic with respect to exponential, respect to p, sorry. And so this is just on sigma square is just the time step. Okay, so that's another standard choice. In this case, it's not very symmetric. So I will concentrate more on this case. Okay, even though we have results also in this case which are less complete. So let's focus on that. And so again, the question is how to choose sigma as a function of n. Okay, that's so this is the seminal paper on this subject by Gareth Roberts, Gell-Mann, Gilkes in 97, where they consider the following setting, which is quite restrictive, as you will see. So first, we want to send the dimension to infinity. So we have to be in a situation where it means something. We have to send the dimension to infinity. So we need to have a natural index labeling, if you want, of the target probability as a function of n. Okay. And the first thing you can think about is the case of IID, random variable, so product measure, if you want. Okay. So this is what we take. Okay. The p of x is just the product of exponential minus v of x I. Okay. So it's just IID target. Okay. So of course, here we are going a little bit far from applications, because if you are this to sample, you would just sample one of them with independent chains, okay? But okay, so there are extensions to that, but this is one assumption which is done. The second assumption, which is even maybe more surprising in terms of application, is that you start from what you are looking for, okay? You start from the probability that you want to sample, okay? This is called the stationarity assumption. So the starting point is p, what you want to sample. So of course, you will, by construction, you will remain always under p. Okay, that's the two assumptions. Okay, let's take them for granted for the moment. Under these two assumptions, you want to look at the limit n goes to infinity. So a little bit like in the previous talk, we do a propagation of chaos results. Okay, so we take one coordinate. Okay, so x1n is the first coordinate of the vector xnk, okay, and we send n to infinity, okay. And now we have the sigma to choose. So now sigma will depend on n, okay, and the correct scaling, so the one for which you don't have a trivial limit, is this one. So what I call a trivial limit is what? If you depart from this scaling, you will either fall in a situation, you will either be in the situation where the acceptance ratio is 1, you always accept. Or you will be in a situation where the limiting acceptance ratio will be 0, you never move. Okay? So in both cases, we say it's not a good scaling, because what I explained before, if it's 1, I should have taken a sigma a little bit larger because I can move more. Okay? If it's 0, I should have taken a sigma a little bit smaller because I'm stuck. Okay? I never move. This is bad in terms of sampling. So there is a balance here to find. Okay? And I will explain a little bit how you can find this from computations. This is the right scaling to obtain a non-trivial limiting acceptance ratio, average acceptance ratio. You take this, and then you have what you do is that you do a diffusive rescaling in time. So it means that you have here a Markov chain, which is indexed by integers, okay? And you go to a continuous in-time process by multiplying the time by n, okay? So this is just this is nothing but the diffusive scaling, okay? It's exactly done to end up with the diffusion. And so you consider actually the limit of this guy under this assumption on sigma n. And you can prove the following. You can prove that this process converges in law to a diffusion, which is solution of this SDE, okay? So it's a stochastic differential equation, which of course has as an invariant measure exponential minus v. Okay, this is just a consistency result. And what is interesting is that here you have a h of l, which is in front of the dt, and the square root of h of l, which is in front of dbt. So if you think about it by just a rescaling of time, there is a compatibility between these two terms, okay, in terms of rescaling of time. And this h of l is explicit. So what is l? It's the constant which is there. Sigma n is l over square root of n. And this function is explicit in terms of l, okay? It's 2l squared times the cumulative distribution of the Gaussian function applied to something which depends on v and on l, okay? So then the question, because, okay, so we know that we should use this scaling, blah, blah, over square root of n to end up with something non-trivial. And then the next question is how to choose the constant l. What is the natural idea? I choose the constant L in such a way that this limiting SDE goes to equilibrium as fast as possible, okay? So in other words, I want to take L so that H is maximum, okay? And when you plot H, good news, there is a maximum. So the maximum is at some point L star, which is some numerical constant about 2.38 over the square root of this function of V, okay? So this is there is it means something to maximize the speed of convergence to the limiting distribution, but the better news, okay, the best news in this story is that if now I consider this optimal L, if you want, and for this optimal L I look at the average acceptance rate, okay. This average acceptance rate, so I plug here with this value of L. In the large n limit, again, it converges to a constant, okay, so some a of l. And if I took the a of l star, it's something which is independent on v. So this is great, because if I had to optimize in l, I need to knew something about the limiting distribution, which is not very practical. But the a of l, so the acceptance rate when I am at the optimal l, does not depend on v at all. So this gives rise immediately to an algorithm. What do you do? You want to scale you are looking for the sigma, for the how far you go, okay? How you choose the sigma? You choose the sigma in such a way that in average you accept the move about 25% of the time, 1 out of 4. Okay? So if sigma is too large, basically you will reject a lot, so you will reduce it, okay? And if it's too small, again, you will increase it. Up to the point that in average, you accept 1 out of 4 times. Okay, so why this paper was very successful? Okay, it's because at the end, basically, it justifies what people were doing. Okay, because it's very natural to do that, and you know this paper says you should do that. You should do it from a theoretical viewpoint. It's very it's meaningful to do that. Okay, so that's a the beginning of the story, 97, okay? And so all this justifies a constant acceptance rate, I should say, average acceptance rate, if you want, strategy with a target acceptance rate of about 25%, okay? So there is a whole bunch of literature about that, changing a little bit the target measure, changing a little bit the proposal. You change the 25% to various values, okay? So there is a zoo of values, but the take-home message is that there are many cases where you can justify, under the assumption I've given before, that targeting a constant acceptance rate is a good idea. Okay, so it makes sense from a practical viewpoint, and it makes sense from a theoretical viewpoint. Okay, so here is a little bit a review on that. So under these two assumptions, on many proposals, you have many people who have contributed, so I don't go into the details, but basically here, these are various ways to propose, okay, beyond random walk. So you can go to MALA, for example, which is a metropolis-adjusted Langevin algorithm I presented at the beginning, where you have the gradient of log of p. There are things beyond a little bit H1. So H1 was the case, the assumption that you have IID target, okay, product measure. So there are ideas in that, in particular for mean field, and in particular to when you have a reference measure which is Gaussian, okay, and you have you have a density respect to this reference measure, okay, in the limit n goes to infinity. In particular, papers by Andrew Stewart on that. But what we are interested in this talk is going beyond H2, so the stationarity assumption. Okay, we would like to understand to say something about the case where we don't start at equilibrium. Okay, can we say something in this case? So up to our work, there were not many things about that. There were partial results for a Gaussian target. Okay, but okay, so it was not that explored. So this is what we tried to do. So this is the dynamics we are looking at. So we keep the first assumption. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, we are still under the case of product measure, okay, for the target. But now we start under whatever measure. Okay, we do not start at equilibrium, and we do metropolis Hastings. Okay, so this is a rewriting of metropolis Hastings in a quite compact way. We start from xk, okay, and for the IF component, we move to we add L over square root of n of j, a Gaussian measure. And here there is an indicative function of an event, and the event is that you accept the move, okay? And accepting the move is what? Is that if you have a uniform law according to 0, 1, is smaller than, you remember, p of y over p of x, okay? So the p of y over p of x is, in that case, the exponential of the sum of the v at the starting point minus the v at the proposed move, okay? So that's nothing but the metropolis Hastings algorithms with Gaussian proposal, and we target the product of the exponential measure. And so what we want to do is to go to n to infinity here, okay? So first, there is again a propagation of Kao result, okay, that I state again under the same setting as Julien did. So what I do, I look at the first of at the first coordinate, if you want, so the x1 n. I choose a sigma which is again L over square root of n, the same scaling as before, okay, and I accelerate time again in a diffusive regime, okay, the same as before, and you end up with again a stochastic differential equation, okay. The main difference with the case when you start at equilibrium is that it's a nonlinear stochastic differential equation, in the sense that the coefficients, the drift on the diffusion term, they depend on the law. Okay, so it's a little bit like in the previous talk. They depend on the law here through some averages. So there is a function j which is fully explicit on a function gamma which depend on two moments on the law. So you have the expectation of v prime of xt square, one quantity, and the expectation of v second of xt. Okay. So these are deterministic functions of time, which depend on the law at time t of xt. Once you know a and b, you plug them in j and gamma, and this gives you this term in the drift, this term in the diffusion. It's clear? On the j and the gamma are explicit. Not very nice, but okay. You can have explicit formulas for these guys as a function of the cumulative distribution function of the normal law, which appears in the limit because of some central limit theorem, okay, which is involved when you send n to infinity. So of course, if you start at equilibrium, okay, oof, you are back to the case I presented before, because the a in this case is equal to b, because the expectation of v prime square is this, and you integrate once by part, and you end up with b. So a is equal to b when you are at equilibrium, And second, when A is equal to B, you can compute that gamma of FA is equal to 2J of AA, is equal to the exactly the H of L I presented before. So I end up with the SDE I presented before. Okay, so everything is consistent. Okay, but now we have a description of what is going on in what you call a non-stationary case, okay, or a transient case. So what can actually prove something which is a little bit in this business, what you can prove is typically a propagation of Kao result, which is a little bit more general than what I'm presented. The thing is that if you take not only the first component, but the k first components, okay, they will converge to independent copies of the first one, k. Okay, so you have to, the idea is that if you keep a fixed number of components, k, and you send n to infinity, you get the same result, and you get independence in the limit. So this is standard in this field. One thing also is that you can compute the limiting acceptance rate, okay, which is explicit in terms of gamma. Okay. So I would like to stress that gamma on J depends on L. Even if I do not make this explicit, they depend on the L. This will be important in the second part of the talk when I would like to optimize the rate of convergence to equilibrium, I will play with the L. For the moment, L is fixed, so I forget about the dependency on L. But and so also, the limit acceptance rate depends on L, and there is a formula. Okay, this is just a detail. So how does it work, the proof in this case? So it's not like in what Julien presented. We do not use a coupling argument to send N to infinity. We use an argument based on compactness. Okay, so you write a weak formulation of your SDE in terms of a martingale problem. Okay, you show some compactness, some tightness on the sequence of flows. Okay, and you show that by passing to the limit, you converge to the weak solution to the SDE, and then there is a uniqueness of result for this weak problem, which tells you have a solution of what you think. Okay, so that's typically the way the proof is done. So this is just about the way the martingale problem is posed. Basically, you take a test function phi, you apply e tau, and you show that phi of xt minus the integral of some L of phi of xt is a martingale. Okay, and the thing, it's a nonlinear, the fact that the process is nonlinear comes back, is related to the fact that the operator, the infinitesimal generator you get here, depend on the law of xt. Okay, so you have here L, which is defined for a given probability measure mu applied to a test function phi by this. And you find here again the average of V prime square, the average of V second. Okay. D'accord? And so the martingale problem, you say that you have a solution in law, a solution to the martingale problem, if for all test function, the difference between phi of yt minus the integral of this, qt being the law of, this is a solution, this is a martingale. Okay. So there are general results will tell you that there is only one solution. And then you have to prove tightness, compactness result. And here you use there are some classical techniques which have known in this field based on some this kind of estimate. So if you can prove that, you know you are tight, okay, and you have a limit for the limiting process. So what is important from that, what I would like just to explain a little bit, is how you find the formula for gamma on J. Where does this come from? Okay, so let me just explain that. For example, so the first question is, why do we scale like one for something constant over square root of n? Why is it the correct scaling? So the idea is to look at the limiting acceptance rate, so the probability to accept, which is that, okay, given that you know all the past up to time tn, okay, so up to time up to xn. This is the formula, okay. And so what you do here, you have sigma n. Okay, so what you say, okay, as n goes to infinity, sigma n will go to zero. So I just make a second order expansion of this. This is what is done here. Okay, you have error terms. Okay, and now what you do here is that you just have to compute the expectation of some exponential of something infimum with one for some Gaussian. Okay, and this is explicit. Okay, it's a nightmare, but it's explicit. Okay, so and this is why. So you end up with this formula with AA and BN, which are defined by that. And when you look at that and you ask, I want a limit, what do you take? You take sigma n square is equal to something over n, of course, to have a law of large number. Okay. So this is how the how the scaling on sigma n comes into the picture. Okay, just this computation. So this gives you this scaling. And so once you have this scaling, you choose it, you try to see if you have a solution to your martingale problem. So what do? You look at the expectation for a test function of the phi of xk plus 1 given xk. Okay? And you want to end up with this formula, more precisely with this formula over a time step to go from k to k plus 1. Okay? That's exactly what you want to do. So again, what you do here, you have this. What you do a second order expansion. Okay? You have a phi prime, this will be related to the drift. You have a phi second, this will be related to the diffusion. Okay? And so you have to pass to the limit in this to get the limiting drift, and you have to pass to the limit in that to get the limiting diffusion. And it's the same kind of idea. I mean, for the drift, you write the formula, and you end up with the formula for the drift. And for the diffusion, it's the same. Okay? So to do it, to get it formally, it's really easy. Okay? To do the proof, it's a nightmare. Okay? Because to control the terms here, in particular this one, it was wrong in the original paper, actually. So to get the correct, the 1 over n here is really complicated. I mean, you have to be careful. But to get the correct the correct numbers, it's quite easy. Okay, it's not a big deal. It's just Gaussian averages with respect to Gaussian. And so the conclusion is to get back to the martingale problem. So you start from xk, you go to xk plus 1. So you use the diffusive scaling I mentioned. So you introduce the rescale process. Let's call it yk. And so you apply what I've just said. Okay, and you observe that it's exactly over a time step of size 1 over n, this quantity, okay, and this is a martingale, and so you have what you want in the limit, okay. So that's that you recognize, you identify what is the infinitesimal generator in the limit, okay, which is again nonlinear, it depends on the law. So it's not okay. So the proof are technical, but to get the result is not that difficult. So now we know what we converge to. So what is the question? The next question is, okay, so do we converge to equilibrium, and can we optimize the convergence to equilibrium? Okay, so let's start with the convergence to equilibrium first. Can we say something? So this is a limiting process again. Huh? This is a nonlinear diffusion with A and B. First thing, I would like exponential minus V to be the invariant measure. Okay, otherwise I'm doing something which is a little bit weird, and this is true, no problem. Exponential minus V is a unique invariant measure. How do you prove that? You say, first, you say that it is true. So if I take exponential minus V, if I compute the A and the B associated to that, I plug it there, okay, it is correct, okay? But more than that, since you can show that the infimum of gamma is strictly positive, you can show that this, the limiting measure admits a density, okay? Let's call it psi infinity. For this psi infinity, you can introduce the associated A and B. Okay, this is A associated to psi infinity and B associated to psi infinity. Okay, once you have A and B, which is there, you know what is psi infinity because here it's a 1D SDE. Okay, with a constant time V prime plus a constant time a dBt. You know explicitly what is the invariant measure for this diffusion. It's exponential minus 2J over gamma times V. J and gamma depending on psi infinity through A and B. And so you have a kind of fixed point here. Okay? Psi infinity is equal to something which depends on psi infinity. So the only thing to check is that the fixed point admits a unique solution, which is exponential minus V. Okay? And why this is true? You say, okay, let's compute A and B from this formula. Okay? So we make a fixed point on A, B, on the two scalars, A and B. And you, if you do the computation, you can check that A is gamma over 2j AB times B. Okay? Okay, so you compute again, and you check that B gamma minus 2aj over B minus A, which is what the numerator here is exactly 0 by this, okay? And you can check that this is strictly positive. So it is 0 if and only if the numerator is 0, namely if A is equal to B. Okay? And if A is equal to B, then you know that the invariant measure is exponential minus B, because if A is equal to B, the 2J over gamma is equal to 1. Okay? So that's the way it is done. So it's just a fixed point. Okay, so we know that the good candidate for the invariant measure is exponential minus v. And now we want to check that psi t converges to psi infinity. Okay, and is it possible to optimize the convergence to equilibrium? And here I again remind you that for the optimization, I will play with L. Okay, so I remember that gamma and J actually depend on L. Okay. And so to do the long-time convergence, I use entropy techniques. Okay, this is where entropy comes into the picture. So I just remind you here the definition of entropy and log sub inequality. Okay, logarithmic sub OLF inequality. So when you have two measures, nu and mu, you can look at the relative entropy of mu respect to nu. Okay, it's defined by something like that. So in our problem, mu will be the low at time t, and nu will be the low at time infinity, exponential minus v. Okay, so this is the entropy. Okay, you can define also the what is called the Fisher information, which is the gradient of the log of the Radon-Nikodym derivative square times d mu. These are definitions. And associated to these two quantities, there is a functional inequality, which is called a logarithmic sub OLF inequality. So we said that mu satisfies the log sub inequality if and only if you can control the entropy by the Fisher information. Okay? And there is here a 1 over 2 rho, the rho being the what is called the log sub inequality constant. Okay? So here, so this is the definition of the entropy, this is the definition of the Fisher information, and this is the definition of the log sub inequality. Okay? So these quantities are useful to understand the long-time behavior of Fokker-Planck equations. Okay, there are many other ways to understand the long-time behavior of Fokker-Planck equations. When you are in a linear setting, when you have a L which doesn't depend on the law of xt, you can use spectral theory. Okay, forget about entropy and all this stuff. I mean, spectral gives you things which are very interesting, but the good thing with entropy is that it works very well in nonlinear cases. Okay, so I have at least three examples in mind. So this was the three examples I wanted to rush through originally, but I prefer to concentrate on one. One on micro multiscale models for polymeric fluids. This is one thing things on which I worked during my PhD. And another example is for adaptive biasing force techniques. Maybe some of you heard me talking about that, where you have a drift which is learned on the fly. Okay, and this is a third example where again the entropy is the right Lyapunov functional, if you want. Okay, so there is maybe something to prove here, because there is an interacting particle system which is behind. The entropy is a good Lyapunov function because maybe you can pass to the limit in from some Lyapunov function on the interacting particle system to the limit. I don't know, but there are things. Clément Mou is actually working in that direction at the moment, trying to. There is maybe a meta theorem which tells you this is the right Lyapunov function because you have an interacting particle system. Anyway, for the moment, for me, it's just an algebraic constatation. Okay, I just make the computation. Okay, and I just realize. Okay, let's put it that way. I just realize that that's the right functional to consider. If I try something else, it doesn't work. Okay. Okay, so coming back to log sub, you can ask what is a typical measure for which this is true. Okay, keep in mind that if you have at infinity something which is a little bit like a Gaussian, okay, and otherwise which is bounded, okay, it's okay. So we know in a quite general setting what is that a probability measure satisfies a log sub inequality. The problem is to find the rho, okay, so to get the right constant, this is another story. But to prove that there is one rho is not that a big deal. And so let me explain a little bit what these two quantities are natural. Okay, and for this I go to the linear case. So I imagine that I am at equilibrium. Okay, so gamma is equal to 2j. Okay, only the constant. And let's take 2. Okay, so that I have this Fokker-Planck equation associated to my SDE. Maybe I went a little bit too fast on that. I realize. Yeah, so here there was a SDE, and here there was a PDE. So I don't know if it was. For all people in the room, it's clear. But so what is the PDE here? It's the PDE, the partial differential equation, on the density of xt. Okay, xt has a density because you have a positive gamma. Okay, and this rules the evolution of the density of xt. Okay. So here is again you have the drift, and here you have the diffusion. Okay. So when I ask about the convergence of XT to equilibrium, this is a PDE problem at the end. I just have to consider the Fokker-Planck equation, which is there, which rules the evolution of the density. Okay. So from the SDE, you end up to a PDE. And the fact that the SDE is nonlinear means that the PDE is nonlinear because the G and the gamma depend on psi. So this is the notation I use for the average of V prime on V second with respect to psi to make explicit the fact that it's nonlinear. Okay? This is clear?
Yeah.
Oh, you can put it outside inside because it doesn't depend on X. It doesn't depend on X because, it doesn't depend on X because the A and the B are just averages. So these are numbers. So gamma is a number, so you can put inside, outside. I just put it that way because it's nice to understand the long time interval. Yes?
As the gamma and B
satisfy
the property that gamma is in B,
gamma is equal to 2Z times G transpose. So no, so first, I am in a scalar case, so I transform your question in gamma is equal to 2g squared or something like that. And second, no, it's only true at equilibrium. So when A is equal to B, yes. At equilibrium, A will be equal to B, and then this will be true. But in the transient regime, you can start from an initial condition for which basically g and gamma are whatever you want. Well, maybe not, but I mean, they do not satisfy this for sure. It's still an invariant measure because of this argument I presented before, which was a fixed point argument. If I have an invariant measure, it necessarily is exponential minus V. Okay? Clear? Okay, so I start from this Fokker-Planck equation in the linear case when gamma is equal to 2j and is equal to 2, okay? And this is again the PDE, okay? And I write it in a slightly different way, which is dx of psi infinity times dx of psi infinity, okay? So this is correct because psi infinity is equal to exponential minus v, okay? And this is a dx of psi times exponential v. So when you just make the differentiation of this product, psi times exponential v, you will end up with that, okay? It's just clear, okay? So I just wrote that, so now I look at the derivative of the entropy, of the relative entropy of psi with respect to psi infinity. It's that, because when you differentiate the log, it's just zero, okay? You just take it. You replace the dt psi t by that. You integrate once by part. And this is nothing but the Fisher information, okay? So the derivative of this entropy is minus the Fisher information. Okay? This is free light. So what do we get from that? Okay? Two things. The first thing is that if you have a log sub inequality with respect to the invariant measure of psi infinity, you can bound from above minus I by minus 2 rho h. And by Grunwald, you have exponential convergence of h to 0. This is what is written here. And you can also say the converse, because if you have this, okay, for all psi naught, by differentiating this inequality around t is equal to 0, you end up with the fact that psi infinity satisfies a log sub inequality with constant rho. Okay? So in other words, you can see the constant rho, okay, as the rate of convergence, the exponential rate of convergence for these dynamics, okay, with here the constant, which is exactly the entropy at time 0. Okay? If you, of course, here this constant. So this is a classical computation. And again, in this linear setting, you can do similar computation with many other Lyapunov functionals than the entropy. Okay, you have plenty of choices. And in particular, you have natural choices where you consider some kind of L2 norm because you have you can symmetrize things and end up with some spectral point of view, which was a little bit explained in the talk by Craig. Okay, but here I use entropy because it's the good functional for my nonlinear problem. Okay. So let me go to the nonlinear setting now. I will try to do the same, but with no psi t, which is solution of the nonlinear PDE. Okay? So this is a nonlinear Fokker-Planck equation. We know the j and the gamma, which depend on A and B. And I want to look at the convergence of psi t to psi infinity. Okay? And so maybe I can try to do it on the blackboard, because people like blackboard here. So let me. Ah ouais, c'est comment? Off. Shit. I should have. Ah, it's mute. It was mute. We'll see. Okay, so let's start from this. Plus gamma dx psi. So since I don't have, yeah, maybe I have it. Dxg v prime plus, yeah, there is a 1/2 already missing. Okay. So this is the and there is a psi, of course. So what we know how to do it in the case where there is no non-linearity. Okay. So let us introduce the case where there is non-linearity. It would be good if J was gamma, what you wanted. Okay. So let's do it. So I just put J minus gamma, okay, V prime psi, and then I have plus dx gamma V prime psi plus gamma over 2 dx psi. Okay? And then it's nice because here I am back to the gentle case. I don't touch about that, but this I can rewrite it as gamma over 2, okay, the dx of psi infinity times the dx of psi over psi infinity. Right? Okay. So now I do what? But I do the computation I've made on the black on the slides before. Okay. I just look at the relative entropy of psi with respect to psi infinity. And I differentiate it with respect to time. Okay. So what do you have? You have dt psi times the log. Again, there is no when you put the derivative on time on that, it's zero. Okay, because integral of psi is always equal to one. Okay, so that. You replace dt psi by these two guys. So let me start with this one. Okay. By integration by part, it's exactly the same argument as before. I will end up with what? I will end up with minus gamma over 2, the integral of the dx of the log of psi over psi infinity square psi. It's the Fisher information. It's the same computation as before in the linear case. But I have an additional term, okay, which comes from that, which is the integral of dx j minus gamma v prime psi times the log of psi over psi infinity. So this is the non-linear part. There is probably a gamma over 2 missing here. Let me think. Yeah, I made a mistake. For this to be true, I need here gamma over 2, sorry. Tac, 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 tac. With gamma over 2, which is in front of everybody. Okay. So what do I do? So again, at equilibrium, G will be equal to gamma over 2, so real term will disappear, but for the moment, it is here. So what do I do? When you look at that, let's put the parenthesis. When I look at that, you want to do what? You want to integrate by part, okay? So you integrate by part, and you have minus, so J minus gamma over 2 is a constant, okay? You put the dx on the log, okay? So you have integral of v prime psi, the dx of the log. So you have two terms. You have dx psi over psi. And for the minus log of psi infinity, okay, it's a minus of minus v, so it's plus v. So you have a plus v prime. Okay? Just computation. And so if you look again at this term, it's what? If you have a J minus gamma over 2. So the first term, the psi goes out, okay, and you reintegrate by part, and it's minus V second psi. Minus V second psi, it was B, remember. And for the other term, it's V prime squared times psi. It's A. Okay? So this is fully explicit in terms of A and B. Okay, so I have the derivative of the entropy which is minus gamma over 2, the Fisher information, as always. Gamma depends on A and B, huh? So it's as always, but... And then there is this term, okay? Minus G minus gamma over 2 times A minus B. Okay? So here you think first about scalings. You know that the entropy, the Fisher information, these are order 2, okay, quantities. And here it's a little bit weird because we say, okay, is it order 2? So when I go to equilibrium, A goes to B, so this is 1, 0, let's say. But G goes to gamma over 2, so this is the other one. Okay, so I have indeed something which is of order 2 when in the regime psi goes to psi infinity. So I just write it explicitly. For example, I divide by A minus B, and I put A minus B square. And this quantity will have a non-zero limit when A goes to B, so when psi goes to psi infinity. Okay? So this is an explicit function. It's a function I've shown before. If I put the 2 here and the 2 there, it's the 2j minus gamma is over A minus B is exactly the quantity I presented before, which is strictly positive. Okay? So this is strictly positive. Quantity. No, no. What is positive is the other one, gamma minus 2j. So this is strictly negative, and with the minus, it's strictly positive. So here you say, bad news, because I have something which brings energy into the system. Okay? So have, okay. But on the other hand, it's reasonable, because when psi goes to psi infinity, this A will go to B. So the only question is, can I control this in terms of the entropy of the Fisher information? Okay? And here comes the trick. Yes? Yes. So, yeah, in the sense that there is not the when A goes to B here, so they don't go to zero. What goes to zero is 2j minus gamma. Okay? It's this linear combination which goes to zero. And it goes to zero like A minus B squared times something. So when I divide by A minus B and I send to A to B, I have a non-zero quantity. Okay, so it's a derivative here, yeah, I'm computing it. Okay, so that's so now I want, so this in the limit, this will have a finite limit. So I cannot say, I cannot gain anything. I need to control this guy, okay? And here comes the trick. I don't remember exactly the date when I found it, but that it's a trick. I mean, it's quite weird. So I look at A minus B, so I have A, it's a V prime square times psi, and then you have B, which is V second psi. Okay, and so the question, I want to control that by the H or the I, okay? And so you do the following. You say it's the integral of V prime times V prime psi, okay? And here I do already an integration by part, okay? So if I do an integration by part, I have a plus psi prime square, okay? So this is the first step. And then what you do is that you look at this and you say, it's nothing but the derivative of the log of psi over exponential minus v times psi. Okay? Let's check. So you have dx, so you have psi prime over psi. So this is this term. And then you have plus v prime. Yeah, it seems correct. Okay? And now you do Cauchy-Schwarz. Okay, and you can bound this from above by integral of v prime square times psi, this is A, and integral of the dx of this guy square times psi, this is the Fisher information I. Okay? So that's nice, because now you can bound from what you can have now using all these things. At the end, you end up with d over dt of the entropy is bounded from above by minus gamma over 2 plus, so let's say minus, okay, minus the 2j minus gamma over 2a minus b times a. I. Okay? And this is the function you can explicitly compute. Okay? And I will go back to the slides because I made maybe three computation errors. Maybe it's not correct, but that's the idea. Okay? You can, at the end, you have something which is minus blah blah times I, okay? Which is explicit in terms of A and B. Okay? And here's the trick. So it's the only case where I know that I bound something by the Fisher information. Usually it's entropy, which comes into the picture, but here you need the Fisher information to bound these two guys. And it makes sense again, because you know that when psi goes to psi infinity, A will go to B. So what we are trying is to get an explicit formula for that, and the explicit formula is just there. Okay, you can write this. So now let me try something which is quite dangerous, which is going back to display. I don't know if it will work in less than 5 minutes. I should just push one or twice. One is enough. Okay, so oh yeah, it's doing something, but okay. So what I obtain here is that I obtain d over dt of the entropy is equal to some function sum I, okay? And what you can change is that this function has a sign. So this is what is written here, okay? This function has a sign. So it's minus some function times I, and what is inside here is non-negative. So already you have a if you want an H theorem, but you have the entropy which decreases. Okay, that's already a good news. But you want more. You want to go to zero. Okay, you want to show something. So to go to zero, you have to bound from below this guy. Okay, and using the fact that the entropy decreases, you are able to say that this guy remains bounded from below by something. Okay, so you end up with some kind of this kind of formula. The entropy is smaller than exponential minus t some lambda time h, and lambda depends typically on the entropy, the initial entropy, okay? Because the bound from below on that is related to the entropy, okay? And you know it's bounded from above by the initial entropy, okay? This is the argument. Huh? Bon. Yeah. So I wrote it from 0 to t, but you can start at t naught, okay? And replace it by t naught, okay? And so from a numerical viewpoint, at the end, what we would like to do is at a given time t, given psi t, I would like to make this quantity as large as possible in order to go. Okay, that will be the idea. Okay, here I write it from zero, but of course it will be on the fly. I would like to. Okay, the proof is there, so I did it. I did everything on the blackboard, and I already said that. Okay, so now, okay, so now we know we converge. So now we would like to optimize. The derivative of the entropy is minus some complicated functions times I, explicit in A and B. But so first remark is that this function, you can rewrite it as 1 over B, some function of A over B on L square root of B. Okay, and this is fully explicit in LAB now. Okay, so it's a certain scaling in terms of AB on L. It's not anything. Okay, so when I want to optimize this guy, a priori, I had three parameters for a given L optimized in A and B. Actually, I have only two, okay? For a given L, I should optimize this function where the dependency on A and B is not anything, okay? So it's only a function of two variables that I have to optimize, if you want. And this function is something explicit, but not that easy to handle. And this is the lemma, okay? So this is published in Bernoulli, the proof of this lemma, which is of the level of high school, is 10 pages. So we sent it and we say, okay, the referee will say, don't keep that. So I think these proofs have never been read by anybody else than us. So what we want to do is, for a given L, okay, no, for a given AB, sorry, we want to make this maximum. Okay, so it's maximizing a function of two variables, one parameter being fixed, and the one to maximize the other, okay, and to show that there is a unique maximum, okay. And so it's a nightmare because of the formula, which are not fully nice, okay? But it's possible, and you can show that you have indeed a unique maximum. And of course, because of the scaling we have here, there is a scaling on the maximum, which is written here, okay? So the maximum of the function which is there is right as 1 over square root L star A of B, L star being the maximum of the function where you you fix here to L star, and here you have a parameter S. Okay, that's you can show it. Okay, and you can consider free regime. So we want to look at non-equilibrium cases. Okay, at equilibrium, A is equal to B. So let's look at the two extremes. A over B goes to zero, or A over B goes to infinity. So this gives me two scaling, which are now more or less explicit, which are explicit in terms of there is a x star, which is a numerical constant. But and we can look what happens around equilibrium when A over B goes to 1. And again, we have something explicit for this L star. Okay? Okay, nice. So we know how to optimize in terms of rate of convergence to equilibrium. But now we want to go back to practitioners and say something to them. Okay? And of course, this is not at all explicit because you need this L, well, this L star. You can pre-compute it. You need the A and the B, okay? And this depends on the V, okay? It's integral of V prime, blah blah. So, don't know these guys a priori. So what you do is that you compare to the situation where you would choose the L in such a way that the acceptance rate is a constant, alpha. Okay. I have a formula for the acceptance rate in terms of gamma. And the first thing is that you can show that there is, for a given alpha, there is indeed a A. For a given alpha and a given A and B, there is a L such that the acceptance rate is alpha. Okay, and again, this is this L tilde, which has again a scaling in terms of some function L alpha. And the good news is that this scaling is exactly the same as before. Okay, so in terms of scalings, in terms of A and B, already you can say that, trying to get a constant acceptance rate seems to be a reasonable idea. Okay. And now, of course, the question is how to choose alpha. Okay. I want to choose alpha in such a way that the L alpha function is as close as possible to the L star function. Okay. You can look again at these three limiting regimes, and so you try to get the alpha such that the constant here are the same as before. Okay. When you do that, you end up with free values of alpha depending on the free regime, which are around 0.3. Okay, so that's, it seems to be reasonably consistent, okay, to get a 30%, say, acceptance rate. So we looked a little bit at these free values, and the best compromise seems 0.27, anyway. So that's not a big. And the last thing we do is, okay, let's consider now a Gaussian target. So we even restrict more. Okay, we take the target which is Gaussian. Why we do that? Because in this case, we can even optimize more. We have an explicit formula for the derivative on the entropy in terms of the first moment and the second moment, which fully characterize the law. The law remains Gaussian. We start from a Gaussian. Huh? The law remains Gaussian. So we can write everything in terms of ODEs. Okay. And in particular, the entropy is a function which is fully explicit in terms of this M and S. Okay, and let's, for a given, at a given time, optimize on L the, we maximize the rate of decay. Okay, so it's even, it's the best strategy you could think of. Okay, at a given time, you take the maximum absolute value of the derivative. So we have now three strategies. Okay, you have one where you optimize with the L star. We are one where we optimize the L alpha, so constant acceptance rate for alpha is equal to 0.27. And we have the one which is the most, the best we could think of, which is the L which maximizes this guy. Okay? And actually, we have two more. One which is take the L, which is a constant, the one which is at equilibrium. Okay? If we are at equilibrium, we know there is the best L. Okay? And let's take also this. So we have four strategies. And so here you see five curves, because there is one I forgot. But there is so the one with a constant L is the black one. So this is as a function of time, the convergence to equilibrium, okay, for two observables. So the worst case, the worst strategy is to keep L constant. This is a very bad idea, okay? You should change L as you go, okay? And then the next take-home message is that the other strategies, so L star, L ant, which is the best in terms of entropy, and fixing L alpha, where alpha is equal to 0.27, basically they give the same results. Okay? But this is the good news. In the Gaussian case. This is the Gaussian case. Okay? Because the L ant, we don't know how to implement it if we are not in the Gaussian case. We don't have any, okay? And actually, to implement the constant acceptance rate strategy, you have two ways. Either you know L alpha, the formula for L alpha, which is there, okay? For the Gaussian case, it's reasonable. For other cases, it's not reasonable. So what you do is that you do also an adaptive strategy, which is on the fly, you choose the L in such a way that you target 0.27, which is what people are really doing, okay? So this is why there are two ways to implement the constant acceptance rate strategy, okay? And again, it's not very different. So the take-home message is that the constant L strategy is very bad. The constant average acceptance rate strategy is very close to the L star, okay, which is the strategy which maximizes the exponential rate of convergence, which is also very close to the best strategy you could think of in this Gaussian case. We have similar results on non-Gaussian cases that I present here. It's less different for the L. It's less clear that it's not so good. So here we have things to investigate more. Okay, so these are the two papers. So the first one is about the propagation of Kao result, and the second one is about the long-term behavior to equilibrium. Okay, thank you for your attention. Yes, ma'am. So the speed of convergence, yeah. So here, so at a given time t, you know what is the rate of convergence as a function of psi t. So in particular, at the initial condition around psi naught, you have an explicit formula which gives you the rate as a function of the relative entropy of psi naught related to psi infinity. An upper bound, because there is an inequality here. But we have you have this formula, which indeed gives you, if you want, an explicit rate of convergence around the starting point. So in particular, depending on the psi naught. Okay. And in particular, if you start from a psi naught which is far from equilibrium, so which means in these three regimes, so in these two regimes, you can say something about what is the best L. Okay. So how to choose the L in such a way. So I don't know if it answers your question. So what you can do at each given time t, you can do it, of course, at the initial condition. Okay. Yeah, Max. Yeah, so there are two cases which are of interest. There is one which is you consider some kind of mean field case. So you have some pair interaction. You rescale the space in such a way that you have a limit, okay? And then you ask, can we prove something similar, okay? So there is a paper here by Breyer, Piccioni, Scarlatti in 2004, okay? I didn't look into the details of this paper, so I must admit, so I don't know in particular if it's possible to combine what we did with what they did in order to get something, okay? And another natural setting, as I explained before, is a situation where you have, say, a stochastic partial differential equation. So you have an infinite dimensional problem, and you approximate it by finite dimensional and you send n to infinity to get to the, okay? And in this setting, there are things by Andrew Stewart, okay? So it's typically a setting where you have a reference Gaussian measure, and you have a Radon-Nikodym derivative respect to that, thanks to the SPD, which is nice. Okay, let's put it that way. And so in this case, there are also results, and in particular, there are papers trying to use to generalize our result into that by Andrew and Michaela. What is her name? Autobri. Michaela Autobri. For this, they try to use this non-transient case. But but it's true that it's a big assumption which should be released a little bit to get something more realistic.